Red Wheel Audio presents The Elements of Spellcrafting, 21 Keys to Successful Sorcery by Jason Miller, narrated by Gary Bennett. Introduction. Some witches and magicians think spells are something to be left behind, a phase that you pass through at the beginning of your path, eventually to be cast aside for more spiritual pursuits. Ideas of using magic to find money or love, win against a rival, heal an ailment, secure the home, and turn the wheel of fate in your favor, get abandoned as a youthful endeavor, or perhaps something that you stoop to as a last resort in an emergency. For these folks, spellcrafting is certainly not something that you spend time on as an adult. Call me childish, then, because I am not one of these folks. I love spellcrafting. I have been practicing magic and witchcraft for nearly 30 years. I have dedicated the last of those 3 decades to teaching what I call strategic sorcery, and made a nice career of it too. I have seen remarkable results and flabbergasting failures. I have been party to rituals that saved lives and others that blew them up. I have learned something from each spell about what works and what doesn't. I'm not claiming to be the smartest, the most powerful, or the wisest sorcerer on the block. In fact, I know that this is not the case. But I have seen some shit, dear listener, and have learned a lot from it. I think most people who try spells know that they work. A little extra money comes in, a person they are attracted to shows interest back, a health condition improves. Spells work enough to convince the caster that magic is real. But it is rare that the result is anything that would actually change one's life for the better in a significant way. This is what this book is about. If people have ever asked you something like, if spells work, why aren't you more successful? This book is for you. The issue is not with the magic itself, but with the application. If you apply these keys skillfully, no one will ever ask you again. What follows is a list of 21 keys that show both how to do effective magic and to apply it in ways that matter, not just for solving a problem at hand, but for building a life filled with worldly success, spiritual fulfillment, and profound meaning. 3 parts of this book. The book is divided up into 3 parts. In the first section, setting up the spell, I lay out the elements of planning that will help ensure success in your work. This involves having a firm grasp on what spells are capable of accomplishing, looking for the enchantable points that can be best affected by magic, and some advice on how best to form spell strategy for maximum impact on those points. The second section, execution, details some of the key considerations involved in actually casting spells. Many of these involve regular practices that will impact any magic you do, and others are about how to weave different spells together to approach the same goal from different angles. We will turn some of the old nuggets of common wisdom on their heads and show how there are other ways of thinking. In the third section, advancing your craft, I will lay out forward-thinking strategies that can optimize your craft for building a better life. This is the section that will take you from novice to master. Oh, one other thing. There are comics that start every key to illustrate one of the points. There is no particular reason for this. I just like comics and think they're funny. Some people seem to think that books on magic should all be hardbound in basilisk leather with only very serious and arcane words. I, however, think magic can be found in a nice, easily available book with some snarky humor. The importance of spellcraft. I don't suspect that many people know this, but an essay on Witch Fox called Spellcrafting, the Real Witch's Craft, was the spark that ignited my career. I wrote it to refute 2 types of posts that were prevalent that month back in 2005. The first suggested that spells were detracting from the spirituality of paganism and preventing it from taking its place among the world's great religions. The second were posts about how the details of magic, the colors of candles, the herbs, the words spoken, did not really matter, and all that really mattered was intention. To the first point, I simply must say that all religions have their sorcery. In some, like Tibetan and Thai Buddhism, it is right out in front for all to see. In others, it is connected to a mystical strain of the religion, like Kabbalah within Judaism or Sufism within Islam. In yet others, it is folk practice that, while not endorsed by the mainstream, still has a far reach. Examples such as various strains of saint magic throughout the Catholic world, or hoodoo within African-American Protestantism, also fit the bill. In short, sorcery is everywhere. In most cases, magic and religion have an odd relationship, where magic attempts to control or mitigate the perils and pitfalls of life, while religion attempts to explain and give coping tools for when magic fails. Magicians often fall afoul of religion for not conforming to dogma and for usurping the power and connection to the world of spirit that is supposed to be the providence of the priest. Even within the mainstream religion, we may consider intercessory prayer as a type of magic. Rituals are taken beyond simply praying, such as prayers repeated for a magically important number of nights, or the manipulation of statues and icons, or the making of offerings, are the first steps in dispel work proper. The line between religion and magic is blurry at best. As to the second point that the Witchvox crowd was so fond of, that intention is the only necessary element in magic, the idea is hogwash and kind of offensive. A Theban magician did not painstakingly preserve and hide the Greek magical papyri with its many formulas because intention was all that mattered. The grimoires were not passed among a network of underground clergy and literate laity because the precise instruction did not matter. Families of African slaves did not preserve traditions of Congolese magic in the New World at risk to their life just because your intention is all that matters. Yes, it's true that substitutions can be made and that magic does not work through slavishly adhering to dogmatic instructions. But it's a bit disrespectful to suggest that the instructions do not matter. What I hope you get out of this book. Magic works. And if you're listening to this book, I assume you know or at least believe that already. If you don't know that already, I'm not going to try to convince you. What I want you to get from this book is not just more instruction in how to perform magic, but how to do it well. Chances are that this is not your first book on magic, witchcraft, or the occult, and you likely have enough spells on your shelf already. If you are a magician, you have catalogs of dozens of spirits and instructions on how to conjure them. In this book, the focus will be on how to apply spells and how to get the spirits to offer aid in meaningful ways. This information is what will make the difference between a life in which magic provides some weird experiences and helpful coincidences, versus a life in which magic plays an integral role in realizing your true potential, achieving personal success, and giving back to the world. Jason Miller, The Feast of St. Cyprian of Antioch, The Sorcerer Saint, September 26, 2017. Part 1. Setting up the spell. 7 keys for making sure that your magic will mean something. Key 1. Know what magic actually does. In this comic, our sorcerer, Harold, has conjured Salfagor, a demon who can influence the weather.
"Demon, bring me a storm of ice and snow."
"Dude, it's July. I can do a cool rain. Little hail, maybe?"
Before we can talk about the best ways to apply sorcery to your life, we need to talk about what magic can actually do. Because magic is a subtle pursuit that is not even acknowledged as real by many people, this is not as clear as you might think, even to its practitioners. By far, the most popular definition of magic is from Aleister Crowley. Magic is the science and art of causing change to occur in conformity with will. Ever since Crowley set this definition down, people have been adding qualifiers to it to fit their particular spin. Dion Fortune seemed to be concerned that people would take some of the promises of traditional magic too literally and lose track of the inner transformation she hoped magic would cause. So she changed Crowley's definition to read, "Magic is the art of causing changes in consciousness in conformity with the will." Donald Michael Craig, author of Modern Magic, was worried that Crowley was too broad and that his definition could be applied to literally anything. So he said, "Magic is the art and practice of causing change in accordance with will, using methods not currently accepted by science." Frater U.D. had an interest in pushing the chaos magic idea, that altered states of mind are the key factor in working magic. So he added, "Magic is the science and art of causing change on a material as well as a spiritual level to occur in conformity with will by altered states of consciousness." If you start Googling, you can probably find a dozen or more spins on Crowley's definition, each reflecting a vested interest of the writer. Rather than add on to Crowley's classic definition, I would like to simply change a key word that I think instantly improves understanding of magic and how to use it. Magic is an influence, not a cause. If I could only change one thing about Crowley's definition, it would be this. Magic is the science and art of influencing change to occur in conformity with will. The key here is to take out the idea that magic is a direct cause of change and instead make it an influence upon change, one influencing factor among many, the nudging of fortuna. This is a much truer description of not just magic, but almost any attempt at change. Whatever the effort, your influence is in competition with other influences, some of which support your goal, some of which work against it. If we are trying to sail a boat to Greece, we have the influence of the wind, the design of the sail, the quality of the boat, the skill of the other crew members, and a dozen other factors impacting the journey. When you extend this idea out, we can look at how the diet of the crew and events in their personal lives will impact the quest. We also have unforeseen events that may pop up that will have an impact. Something as large as a sudden storm or as small as a distracting glimmer have impact. Whatever action we take directly to make our sailing successful, it is amidst this sea of influences. When we get into magical goals, the idea of influencing change rather than causing change is key. It shows us why spells that aim to divert a coming storm will work better than attempts to make it snow in July. One of these is an event that just needs a nudge. The other requires a drastic suspending of the laws of nature. Magic as an influence rather than a cause is why enchanting for a better job or to start a successful business is a good investment of time, while spells to win the Mega Millions lottery are a fool's errand. As far as modifying Crowley's definition of magic further, I would even drop the "in conformity with will" line. That line speaks much more to Crowley's thelemic philosophy than it does to the practical aspects of magic. It also negates the not infrequent occurrences of accidental magic manifesting in the lives of practitioners. Influencing what, exactly? So, if magic is an influence rather than a cause, we need to think about what it influences. The answer isn't simple because sometimes truly miraculous things can happen, things that defy explanation. You do a spell for love and find someone sitting on your doorstep when you get home. You do some healing to reduce a tumor, and your next checkup has the doctors scratching their heads because they have never seen a reversal like that. One friend of mine, Sarah Mastros, conjured the spirit Sabnok, who, according to the Goetia of Solomon, grants castles, and wound up moving into an apartment in the historic Henry Lister Townsend Castle in Philadelphia. But scenarios like this are not the norm. These occasional and exceptional occurrences happen from time to time, but you can't bank on them. In general, magic is an influence upon two things, events and minds. By events, I mean just about anything that has a probable chance of happening, from a storm to a car accident to a raise at work. Magic doesn't make these things happen, but it can influence them. By minds, I mean the classic enchantment of spellbinding, influencing what a person or even groups of people think. A lot of people get concerned that they might be robbing someone of free will by doing magic for this, but it's important to remember that magic is just an influence like any.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.